Good morning. It's Loren Lockman from the Tanglewood Wellness Center. And I'm going to be talking a little bit this morning about what is food. You know, I'm frequently asked, how about this, how about that? People want to ask about every single food item they can think of. And I realized some years back that rather than trying to have people remember all these things, what is and isn't okay, it might be easier for people to teach them how to think about what belongs in the body themselves. And so I came up with these guidelines that I call What is Food? You know, we talked just the other day about how silly it would be to have five squirrels sitting around in a tree talking about what is food for their bodies. And so let's start by just acknowledging that it's kind of absurd that we even need to have this conversation. And I think the fact that we do demonstrates that singularly among all the roughly 800,000 animal species, we are out of touch with our own bodies and needs. Or perhaps we simply think too much, right? You know, because every other species, they know what to do. They don't have to think about it. There are millions of divergent opinions about what a healthy diet looks like and very little agreement on that. And that, again, isn't that kind of odd? How we don't know, after all these years, what actually belongs in our own bodies. So I'm gonna do my best. What I'll be sharing with you are the guidelines that I've found have worked for me and have worked for the people that I've worked with over the last 20 years plus to help them achieve an amazing level of health. And I'll do my best to answer all the questions about each one as we go. Again, I'm gonna ask you guys to hold your questions until the end of each section. At each section, I'll stop and take questions about that section, then we'll move on. So, you know, it occurred to me some years ago that people seem to think that food is anything that they can put in their body and not immediately fall down dead, right? If they can chew it up and swallow it and doesn't kill them, that must be food. And if you look at some of the stuff people are eating some pretty nasty stuff out there. But because it doesn't kill them right away, they think it's food. And it's not a bad definition except for the time frame. I mean, the fact is that the vast majority of people are dying as a result of what they eat. It just takes longer, and so it's not noticed by most people. There's no clear connection between the meals they're having now and the heart disease and cancer they develop later. But there's a connection, they just don't see it, okay? So these guidelines I'm gonna give you, they all start with the same phrase. You might wanna write this down. That first phrase is, to be food for a species. And so you can notice that, you know, if you're watching this right now and you're not a human being, maybe you're a cat or a dog, or, you know, whatever it might be, this will work for you too. This works for every species. Okay, to be food for a species. Now the second half of each of the guidelines is going to be different, but they're all going to start with that same phrase. The first one says, to be food for a species, a substance must contain valuable nutrition. Okay? Now, some of you are probably thinking, well, duh. I mean, after all, who would ever eat empty calories? Who would ever eat food that didn't contain real nutrition? Would anybody ever do that? Can you imagine people doing that? Well, if you go to a grocery store, you know, an average grocery store in the United States today has roughly 50,000 food items, so-called food items. I would suggest that probably 49,950 of them are garbage. That maybe a fraction of a percent are actually food, okay? So there are many things that people eat. In fact, this happens so commonly that we have a term that everyone's familiar with to describe these kinds of substances. What do we call it? What do we call these things? Junk food signifying there's no nutritional value to it. Okay, but what I want you to understand is that in nature, when an animal gets a message from its body to eat, when it gets that message that it's hungry, it's looking for both calories and nutrients. Because in nature, there are no empty calories. Everything contains calories and nutrients, okay? So our bodies are looking for the same thing. And in fact, know, when we think about the fact, and this is actually unusual, this is the first time in a long time that we have everyone here grew up in the United States. Were you born in the U.S.? Everyone here was born in the U.S. We usually have not. Okay, I take it back. Everyone here was not born in the U.S. Because it's you. We usually have, and we were actually supposed to have three Europeans here this session. They couldn't get here for various reasons, as well as you. In the U.S., where the average person, the population is now 70% overweight or obese, right? The average person's walking around with between 2 and 4 months worth of calories. So the average body doesn't need any calories at all. It's got plenty of calories. It's got enough calories to go from here until Christmas. The average body, literally. Many of them. So what's the body looking for? It's looking for nutrients. But what are people doing most often? Eating empty calories. This, by the way, is one of the reasons that so many people are overweight. I mean, imagine for a second, your body sends you a message. It says, you know, we could use some more nutrition. Let's tell the brain to get some food. And so the apostat sends this message that your brain says, oh, hunger, I'm hungry. And so what do you do? What does the average person do? Well, they go to the freezer, they take out a half a gallon of ice cream, and they chow down the whole thing while they're completely not conscious and watching TV. And so they've just consumed, I don't even know how many calories that is. Anybody have a guess? 3,000? 4,000? 5,000? You know, let's say they consume 3,000 calories. That's 2 days worth of calories for me, sometimes 3 days worth of calories for me. And yet their body wanted not calories, but nutrients, and didn't get any. And so guess what happens in another hour or two? Body says, hey, get me some more food. Because it's looking for nutrients. And so the person says, you know what? I'm going to run down to the donut shop. And they get a dozen donuts. And they just eat another 4,000 calories. And the body says an hour or two later, well, that's fine, but you know, there's no nutrition here. Give me some more food. And so people are getting messages to eat because the body is constantly looking for nutrition and not getting it. Okay? So when the body sends a message called hunger, we're looking for calories and nutrients. If something doesn't contain nutrition, it's not food. Is that clear to everybody? This is a simple one. By the way, I'm hoping that every single thing I tell you today and tomorrow, when we finish this, you're going to go, yeah, I knew that at some level. Because I believe you already know everything you need to know. My job is to remind you of stuff you haven't been paying attention to, perhaps. Okay, or forgetting to actually apply to your life. But there's no new information. We all know this. And we've lost connection, but we all know, like every other species, what we need to eat. We really do at some level. Problem is, because we live up here, we've lost connection to it. So anybody have any questions on this first one? This is pretty basic, isn't it? All right. The second one says, to be food for a species, a substance must be completely non-toxic to that species. Must be completely non-toxic to that species. Okay? So, now again, this may seem kind of silly. I mean, who would eat stuff that's toxic to them? Would anybody here ever consume anything you knew was toxic or harmful to you? Well, most people are doing that all the time. I mean, don't you think most people know that alcohol's not really good for you? Maybe caffeine's not really good for you. Sugar is not really good for you. Junk food, people know it's not good for them, but they do it anyway. Okay? But a lot of these substances are actually literally toxic to the body and are directly contributing to the disease process. And so to be food for a species, real foods never include things that are actually toxic to the body. It's okay. You see, he can come here too if he wants. Okay, so anything that's toxic to the body is not really food. Now, this is controversial, but what's toxic about coffee? Anybody?
Caffeine.
It's acidic. It contains caffeine, and a variety of other chemicals, which are excitotoxins. These are toxic compounds. Well, guess where else these things are found? How about raw chocolate? Cacao contains these exact same chemicals, but it's a superfood. Who says who? It's a superfood, according to some people, because it contains a lot of nutrients. But if something contains toxic compounds, why would you eat it? There's no reason to. We don't need it. There's nothing in that that we need. Okay? Now, you know, with the exception of eating at a raw food restaurant with Kat in Las Vegas a month or two ago, you know, I haven't eaten raw chocolate. I don't eat that kind of stuff usually. It's not here. I don't have access to it. I don't want access to it. I don't make it. I don't have cacao. You know, it's not, I don't consume superfoods ever, twice a year, if ever. Okay, there's no need for them, right? So be clear about that. What our bodies need are whole, real foods, not something that someone's labeled a superfood because of its nutritional breakdown. You know, there are many places around nutrition where we make these silly choices. I think I pointed out to you guys before, we might be getting a little bit ahead here, but essential fatty acids, right? Nutritionists say, the official word is, eat cold water fish, deep water fish, salmon, mackerel, contain tons of EFAs. Essential fatty acids, things that are essential, we need these things. Eat them, eat this stuff, eat this fish, unless you're pregnant or breastfeeding. Why not in those cases? Oh, because it's poisonous. They contain a lot of toxins. So people who are pregnant or breastfeeding shouldn't eat them. Why should anybody eat them if they're toxic? Well, the answer is nobody should. Okay? But what we often do is we ask poor questions or incomplete questions. So if you ask, is there anything in raw cacao that's good for you? The answer is yeah. It's got lots of nutrients. Well, if you leave it like that, you might think, I should eat this stuff. But what if you then said, is there anything in raw cacao that's toxic to you? Well, yeah, there is. Now, why would you ever eat that when you don't need to, when you can get everything you need from eating whole foods? And again, listen, you know, my goal here is to help each of you that are here with me and anyone watching this understand what's optimal for the body. This doesn't mean you can't go out once a month and have a piece of chocolate pie at your favorite raw food restaurant. Go support those people. Enjoy it. Once your body's clean, I promise you, like me, you're not going to feel very good the next day. Okay, you'll know the toxicity when your body's clean enough to be able to tell you. But if you don't mind spending a day in a little bit of a fog and dragging your butt around a little bit, it's okay. It's not the end of the world. You'll bounce back. Okay? But you'll know at that point, which you may or may not know at this point. Okay? Whole foods or real foods are things that we find in nature in the state we can consume them in, which brings us to the next one that we're not ready for yet. So let me stick with number two. Must be completely non-toxic to that species. Now, why do I say to that species? Some of you have probably been told, you know, if you're lost in the woods, how many people here even go in the woods anymore? If you're lost in the woods and don't know what to eat, just watch what the animals eat and eat that. That's not necessarily the best strategy because that can get you dead. I'll give you an example. Under the tree right out front here, there's a big mango here, but under the hickory tree right here, we have some big plants with big leaves. In fact, you can't see it on the other side of this bookcase. On the porch side of the bookcase, there's a big plant there too. It is in the tobacco family. Okay, those leaves are highly toxic. Everyone knows cigarettes are toxic and cigarette smoke is toxic. But you eat just a little bit of the leaf, you get very sick. Eat a lot of the leaf, it can kill you. Okay, these are very poisonous plants to us. But rabbits eat tobacco leaves all day long. That is an exception. I mean, the idea that look and see what other animals eat would usually work, but not always. The reason it would usually work is because every central nervous system on this planet that's ever been studied, every animal, every insect, Every animal that's been looked at shares the exact same central nervous system design as you and I. It's exactly the same. This is why the pesticides you spray on your grass will kill your little kitten or your little child, your baby, who are much more sensitive to smaller amounts of it. It's toxic to you too, but because you're much bigger, it may not be enough to actually make you sick enough to notice. It's going to affect you though. Poison is poison to every species. Okay, that's the point. However, in this case, the rabbit, over time, through evolution, evolved to be able to digest, process, metabolize that poison. Why would they do that? What would they go to the effort of doing that? Anybody? They have no competition for that food. Because it's toxic to virtually every other species, they have all the food they want. They only have to share it with other rabbits. Okay, so that happens sometimes in nature. Just be clear that the fact that they can eat it doesn't mean that we can eat it. All right, that's not a good strategy. All right, so it needs to be things that are non-toxic to our bodies. Now, coming back to what I said a minute ago, pesticides, right? We were talking about pesticides that you spray on your grass. Does anybody know where pesticides came from originally? Well, it wasn't Agent Orange, which came much later, but at the end of World War II, Dow Chemical and another large chemical company were sitting on stockpiles of chemicals that they had designed and manufactured to kill people in the war. Okay? They had a whole bunch of this stuff left. I mean, it doesn't suck when a war ends too soon, right? Right? So they got all those chemicals left over. They wanted to kill more people, but they didn't have the chance to do it. And they're sitting there with all this stuff thinking, what do we do with this stuff? And someone had a bright idea. Hey, why don't we take this stuff designed to kill people and spray it on our food? Spray it on the crops that we're growing. Wouldn't that be a good idea? I mean, how insane is this? Now, why does it work to dilute this poison and spray it on our food? Because, as I said a minute ago, we all share the same central nervous system design. So the stuff that will kill us will kill insects that will eat the crops. And we don't have to have it in the same quantity. We can dilute it for the insects because, that's the Diablo, because their bodies are much smaller than ours. Okay? But that's where pesticides came from. I mean, think about that. Now, here's the issue with this stuff. You know, yeah, you might be consuming it in relatively small quantities, but these are bioaccumulative substances, which means they accumulate in your tissue. So the second guideline says, be food for a species must be completely non-toxic. What that means is it must have been grown without poison, i.e. has to be organic. And I know that organic doesn't mean what it used to. I can remember when the only organic bananas available 20 years ago in the US were grown by hippies, you know, ex-hippies, businessmen who had started these organic farms because they cared about the environment, they cared about people's health, and they wanted to create a good product. And one day I went into my local co-op, and the normal bananas I'd been buying, the regular brand of organic bananas, weren't there. What they had that day instead were Dole organic bananas. And I said, I don't friggin' think so, because what do we know about Dole? Dole's a massive corporation. Okay? Do they care about human life? What do you think? No. I mean, they're the Dole workers that live in these countries where the bananas and pineapples are grown. They're working with these deadly chemicals, wind up with much higher rates of cancer and other diseases. They don't care. It's about profit. It's about the bottom line. It occurred to me that Dole would probably do the minimum that they had to be able to call their bananas organic. But they were the only bananas available, so I bought them. And guess what? They didn't taste very good. It wasn't the same product, okay? So it's true that organic today may not be what organic used to mean, because over the last 20 or more years, organic has been the largest growing segment of the produce market, of the grocery market, in fact. Not just produce, it's all the packaged organic stuff, all the processed food. So because organics have been growing faster than any other segment of the grocery market, everybody wanted to get in. But what that means is standards come down. Businesses that were interested only in the bottom line figure out how to do organic or get away with, you know, what they call organic at the lowest possible cost, and therefore often a much lower level of quality. But here's what we know. If you're buying something that's not organic, if it's labeled commercial, it was grown with poison. You're still better off with organic. It's got to be better than growing, than consuming something that was poisonous. Now, can you wash the pesticides off of the apple? Absolutely. You can wash your produce, and you can wash off the stuff that's sitting on the skin. However, two problems. One, you're also washing off beneficial bacteria. I mean, I take my organic produce out of my garden and I shove it in my mouth. Okay, I don't wash it first. I'll brush off any dirt that's there, but I actually want something that's not washed. And if it's organic, I don't have to worry about that. But not only are you washing off beneficial bacteria and their B12, which is produced by bacteria, you cannot wash off the pesticides, which are part of every single cell of that apple. Because when you spray the apple tree as the apples are growing, they become part of every cell of the apple. How do you eliminate that? It's not possible. So if you care about your health, you need to invest in organic. I've talked about this with you guys a little bit before. I've told you I've got myself in trouble. And I've offended people where I've said, you know, look, if you don't think you can afford organic, you might want to revisit your priorities. I mean, if your health isn't important to you, it's another story. But if what you want is to function at a high level of health, you need to understand that consuming stuff that is poisonous is not going to help you very much in terms of creating a high level of health. So make the commitment to buy organic. Do what you have to do. There are ways to do. We've talked about forming co-ops and buying clubs and bribing the produce guy to let you know when they're going to be taking those overripe bananas out. They're not really overripe. They're just ripe out to the dumpster. There are things that you can do to bring your and grow as much as you can yourself, you know. But make it organic. And I can tell you for myself. I mean, my last 15 or more years in the U.S. and I left the U.S. more than 8 years ago. So starting 23 or more years ago, I was buying exclusively organic produce when it was hard to come by. But I was committed to my health. That's all I was willing to buy. And there were times when I literally didn't know how I was going to pay the mortgage. And I thought, well, if I lose the house, I can always find another place to live. But if I lose my health again, having already lost it once, I don't know if I'll get it back. So I figured more important to put my money into my body, into my health, than into maintaining a piece of property. And I would do exactly the same thing. I'd make exactly the same choice today if faced with the same circumstances. So I'd encourage you to think seriously about what you're really committed to. As you guys know, that's something I always encourage people to do. Dude, you need to lighten up a little bit. That's the cat I'm talking to. All right, so now we're probably going to wind up coming back around to this one a little later. That'll happen sometimes. Because there's some things that may be toxic to you that you may not realize. In fact, I'm going to share one more piece with you now. And if you're watching this at home, this is probably going to piss you off. It's going to piss off some people here too. But let's talk for a second about herbs. Herbs can be divided into two broad categories. We have medicinal herbs and we have culinary herbs. So medicinal herbs are the things that herbalists prescribe to people or recommend to people to eliminate sickness, disease, whatever it might be. And, you know, we think about this stuff. Where did medicines, drugs, first come from? From plants. They came from plants. They were distilled from plants. So someone noticed, hey, there's something in this plant that creates a certain effect. What if we could figure out exactly what part of the plant's doing that, or what part of the, you know, the sap or whatever it is we're getting from the plant is doing that, we can distill it, make it even more powerful. We can concentrate it. And that's what people have done. That's how we came up with drugs. That's where most drugs started out. But they started out as plants. And so, you know, when I say every drug is toxic to the body, it probably won't surprise anybody watching this video. Now, there are many people that would be surprised, but they wouldn't likely be watching this video in the first place, right, or sitting here at my wellness center. But when we talk about the herbs themselves being toxic, that surprises a lot of people, because a lot of us are, you know, we've, many of us here probably realized some time ago, medicine's not really working for me, I'm going to move away from medicine. But what do we encounter? We encounter these alternatives, including herbs, and we think, well, this has got to be better. And maybe it is. But remember that drugs started from these same plants, and that in fact, the plants themselves are actually toxic to our bodies. That just like drugs, medicinal herbs work, not because they have any power to heal the body. That doesn't happen. Remember, healing happens from where? From inside the body. The body heals itself like every other organism. What the herbs do is they create a symptomatic effect, okay, where we feel better because we've suppressed a symptom. Well, this is exactly what drugs do. It's the toxicity of the plant that's creating that reaction in the body. And what you want to understand is that, you know, an herbalist will tell you, for instance, if you're about to catch a cold, you can take echinacea, okay, but you can only take it so many days in a row, or only such a quantity. That's because of its toxicity. All right? So, that's medicinal herbs. They're all toxic. I'd encourage you to be careful with them. Some people are gonna, you know, are gonna argue with this. I understand it. I'm used to this now. I've been talking about this for over 20 years. But, you know, the fact is, nothing makes your body heal except giving it rest, allowing, getting out of its way so it can heal, which is what you guys are doing right now. Now we've got culinary herbs. And this is where people really get pissed off, right? Don't step on my culinary herbs. So, let me start by pointing something out that I think I pointed out to some of you that are here now. I think you may not have been here yet when we had this conversation. But every species on the planet shares one primary goal. The only exception may be human beings, because we have all kinds of morals about this. Well, what is every other species' primary focus?
Survival?
No. Procreation. Reproduction. Species want to make as many copies of themselves as possible. That's what they're programmed to do. In order for plants to do that, they must survive. So you may not have thought about this way before, but hopefully it becomes obvious when you do that the broccoli can't procreate if you eat it. Does that make sense? It needs to survive in order to be able to procreate. Because of that, most plants on the planet are toxic to our bodies. And the plants, evolutionarily, someone, you know, made a choice, however it happened, plants became toxic to discourage their predators, primarily insects, maybe other predators, from eating them. Plants are toxic on purpose because it benefits the plant to be toxic. How many species on the planet are eating poison ivy? Probably not very many. Okay? It's a highly toxic substance. That plant is using some of its precious resources to make itself poisonous instead of reproducing as quickly, instead of growing as quickly, instead of doing other things. It made choices. And making itself toxic was one of them. Okay? And it's interesting because here in the tropics, we see some plants. You've all seen the leafcutter ants. You guys notice these? These are the ants you'll see walking in a parade, a trail of them, carrying leaf and flower parts. They're often much bigger. You can't even see the ants sometimes. You just see this little piece of a flower walking down the path. Okay? There's a line of these things. And what's interesting is that the ants target plants that are not poisonous to them. Makes sense, doesn't it? But some plants have evolved where, rather than putting their resources into making themselves toxic all the time, they're not toxic until the ants or some other predator begins eating the leaf of the plant. And then the plant starts producing a toxin to discourage that insect from continuing to eat it. Okay, so this, I think, demonstrates clearly this is an intelligent response by the plant to prevent itself from being eaten. Well, this is what most plants are doing. So you go on a wild edible plant walk. Anyone ever do this? How many plants were you shown that you could eat over that, what, 4 or 5 hour walk? 20? 20-ish? Okay. How many plants do you think existed on that 5 or 10 acre piece of land you walked on? Thousands? So 20 out of thousands were edible to you? I mean, if there were 2,000 and you were shown 20, that's 1%. Okay? The other 99% are toxic to us. And even some of the 1% that are edible have to be cooked to break down some of the toxins to make them edible. Okay? So the vast majority of plants are toxic. The fact that culinary herbs are toxic too, I would hope, wouldn't come as a huge surprise. Now, the first time I really started getting some insight into this was after we'd moved to Panama. We moved to Panama, we'd set up a big garden. We were growing tomatoes and lettuce and melons and various other things. And I had a very good friend who was an organic farmer in Panama. And he said, Loren, he said, plant basil upwind. So the wind would come up the mountain. The garden was here, the wind was coming this way. He said, plant basil here, right? On the wind side of the tomatoes. I said, but I don't eat basil, why do I do that? He says, not for you. You plant basil, the wind blows the scent of the basil over the tomatoes and the insects leave the tomatoes alone because basil's poisonous to them. So it's kind of a curious thing because the culinary herbs are all plants that share one thing in common. They produce various toxic substances, alkaloids, that give them their characteristic smell and taste for the specific purpose of not being eaten. And then we come along and say, that smells good, let's eat that. It's kind of ironic, isn't it? Now, who do you think is the basil, for instance, basil's biggest predator? Is it you and I? No, it's the insects. So their toxicity levels are based on discouraging their primary predators, these insects. Does that mean it's non-toxic to us? No. Although most people don't understand this, things are not toxic by degree. A substance is toxic or it's non-toxic. Okay? If it's toxic, there's really no quantity of it that you want to consume for your health. But if you really don't believe this, here's what you can do. Go to the store today, not you guys. You're fasting for a while. But if you're watching this at home, okay, go buy a big bunch of organic basil, a big box of it, okay? Take it home and make a basil salad. I'm not talking about a little bit of basil in your salad. I mean, make a salad of basil. Add some tomatoes, whatever you want, but have a whole big bowl of basil. I promise you, you're going to feel very sick afterward. You will. Okay? Most people will feel very sick afterward because it's poisonous. If you eat enough of it, you will feel it. And if you don't feel it, it reflects on the toxicity of your body. In the same way that toxic people can eat McDonald's and feel fine, or drink a bunch of alcohol and feel fine, and clean systems can't do that, same thing is true here. But most people, regardless of their toxicity, will notice. If they eat enough of any culinary herb, they will feel sick as a result because it is toxic to us. Okay? So does this make sense to anybody here? Now, you know, again, whether you want to believe this or not is another story. I'm encouraging you to take your attachments to specific foods and ideas about those foods and put those aside. We're talking here about simply trying to understand what's optimal for our body. Can you see that plants want to make themselves poisonous so they don't get eaten? Does that make sense? Okay. Can you see that the fact that basil keeps the insects away and may be because of its toxicity? And can you see that eating things that are toxic to the body is probably not optimal for your health? Does that make sense to you guys? So, you know, again, whether you choose to eat herbs or not, the fact is culinary herbs are toxic to the body and you just have to eat enough or get clean enough and then eat enough to find out. If you don't believe me, after you finish your fast, when you get home, go eat a big basil salad. You will find out. Okay? I promise you, any one of you will find out. So let me stop there. Are there any questions about anything I've covered with this guideline? Let me restate the guideline for just a second. To be food for a species, a substance must be completely non-toxic to that species. Questions?
Are you saying that all the foods that you recommend have no toxicity at all?
The question is, am I saying that all the foods that I recommend have no toxicity? That is exactly what I'm saying. The foods that belong in our bodies, that are actually part of our natural diet, are foods that are non-toxic to our bodies. That's what I'm saying.
How And curcumin, which is a root, it's not really culinary herb.
Uh-huh.
So nobody wants to eat that, so it's not like it's going to produce toxins.
As it happens, it is toxic. The question was curcumin. Curcumin. Is this okay to eat or not okay? First of all, as I said to you yesterday, I think, root vegetables, virtually impossible for our bodies to digest raw. They're eaten cooked historically. Why? To break down the cellulose so people can actually digest them. Break down the starch so people can actually digest them. But if you actually Google it, you will find that curcumin and most other spices are toxic to the body as well. Okay? Now, does that mean you can never eat it? No, it doesn't. You can do whatever you choose to do. But doesn't it make more sense to take your head out of the sand and make choices based on actual information about what it's going to do? So if you know it's toxic but you love it, maybe you choose to eat it every once in a while instead of every day. Okay? Any other questions about this guideline? Anybody? Okay, let's do one more today. The third guideline we'll cover today says, to be food for a species, a substance must be edible by itself. Must be edible by itself. Now, this may sound a little strange to most of you, but let me start out by pointing something out. How many of you remember, first of all, we have a couple of you that are around my generation or even older. How many of you remember Mutual of Omaha's Wild Kingdom?
Yep.
Yeah? Matthew? Ever see that back in the early 70s?
Heard of it.
Never saw it. Okay. Sunday nights. Well, we watched this program every Sunday night whenever it was on for a year or two, I guess. I don't know. It was a photo safari of Africa, you know, cool stuff. We saw all kinds of wild elephants and animals and lions and tigers, and it was cool. Say again? Right. And if you haven't watched that show, you've probably seen documentaries, nature documentaries. Maybe you've noticed that it's very rare for a chimpanzee to gather some bananas and then pick a pineapple, and then go pick a few kiwis, and then gather some strawberries, and then go home and make fruit salad. Okay? Yeah. I mean, holidays, special occasions, sure, of course they do that, but day to day, this doesn't happen, right? In fact, what happens in nature is that animals eat one thing at a time, like my cat who eats my hand, mostly, right? Animals are eating one thing at a time at virtually every meal, okay? And people say, well, yeah, it's because they don't have cutting boards and salad bowls. Maybe. You know, maybe it's just because they don't have the tools to make a salad. Maybe if they did, they would. I don't know. But here's, you know, I've realized over these many years now, 35 plus years that I've been studying nutrition and thinking about how to create the highest level of health, that if something happens over and over again in nature, I pay attention to that. So when 800,000 other species eat one food at a time, I think it's worthy of some consideration. Why do they do that? What's going on there? Well, I actually did address this briefly in a talk just the other day. If you recall, we were talking about salads yesterday. And what did I tell you? It might have been a different talk where I said it this way, but you know, if you eat a banana, your virtually infinitely intelligent body says, as soon as you start chewing the banana, your body, which happens if you are chewing the banana, right? Your body looks at what's there and sends a message to your digestive tract and begins to prepare your stomach and your digestive tract for what's coming. It may not know banana, because that's our name. What it knows is there's X amount of this and Y percent of that. This is the consistency, the makeup of that substance. And it prepares the optimal environment for the digestion and then assimilation of that food. If you eat a grapefruit, your body does exactly the same thing. The problem is that when you eat the banana and the grapefruit together, each of them needs a very different environment for its optimal digestion. So if you eat them together, if you eat a fruit salad, what happens is you don't get optimal digestion of anything. You get a compromised digestion of everything. Okay? So you'd be far better off, rather than combining the banana, the mango, the oranges, and the kiwis, to have one meal of bananas and to have another meal of mangoes 3, 4, 5 hours later when you're hungry, not an hour later because you can, but when you're hungry, and then 3, 4, 5 hours later or the next day, have something different. That's what happens in nature virtually every time. There are some few exceptions, but the exceptions are rare and very far between. So eating one thing at a time is the rule in nature. And when we do that, we are ensuring optimal digestion, which again means we will have optimal absorption, which will allow for optimal assimilation. And it may not mean we'll have it because there are other factors, but it will allow for it. You cannot have optimal absorption if you don't have optimal digestion. Okay? Is that clear to everybody? Okay, and you cannot have optimal assimilation if you don't have optimal absorption. So whatever you eat that's not digested is not going to be assimilated. I hope that makes sense. I hope that's clear to everybody. Yeah? Okay. Well, there's one more piece. So if every species eats one food at a time, and that's what's optimal for us, then the guideline which says to be edible to be food for a species, a substance must be edible by itself, that's really a slightly different take on this. Because what that's saying is all those things that we would never make a meal of by themselves aren't food. And therefore, I hope this is clear already, but therefore, we might want to not consume them. So what kinds of things am I talking about?
Meat?
Well, people can eat meat by itself and make a meal of that. I don't recommend it, but that falls under a different guideline. But there are substances that virtually no one's ever going to make a meal of by itself. What kinds of things? Anyone think of anything like that?
Garlic,
onions, oil, vinegar, salt, pepper, spices. Are you going to sit down and make a meal of any of these things? Bowl of sugar? Well, I actually did that when I was a kid. Not a good idea, but, right? No one's going to sit down and have a bowl of oil for a meal. I hope. If you've been having a bowl of oil for a meal, you might want to stop doing that, okay? No one's likely to do any of those things. These are not foods. These are substances which are used to make food, or things that people call food, more palatable. Now think about that for a second. What other species on the planet consistently consumes things that don't taste good enough to eat on their own to that species? I mean, this may be hard for you and I to imagine, but I assure you, a cow, sheep, goat wakes up every morning, looks around and says, "Holy shit, I went to heaven. I'm surrounded by grass. It couldn't get any better than this." Now, grass and little green plants. They love it. That's what they're most attracted to. Okay? You and I would wake up in that field and be, okay, where's the food? There's no food here if there's only grass. Because that's not food for, we're not attracted to that. That's not food for our bodies. No other species takes substances that don't taste good in their natural state and uses condiments and other substances to try to make them palatable. But that's what humans do. You mentioned meat a moment ago. Anyone know how salt came into use? Why is there a salt shaker? It was originally a preservative for meat. Before there was refrigeration, people would salt their meat to cure it so it wouldn't rot. And what happened? I mean, have you ever had the experience of spending hours in the kitchen? I mean, I haven't cooked a meal, like on a stove with heat in over 22 years that I've been raw. But back in the old days when I cooked, I would spend hours in the kitchen cooking food for guests, maybe, right? I was having a little dinner party. So I cook all this food, and one of them sits down, picks up the salt shaker before they taste food, and covers it all with salt. You ever had this experience? You have? Right? You're going, "What are you doing? You're ruining it." Well, I want to assure you, you can rest assured You can relax knowing these people knew exactly what they were doing. They weren't ruining it. They were doing exactly what they needed to do. You see, the problem is that when someone's addicted to salt, that's about all they can taste. When people were eating salted meat, all the rest of their food lost its flavor because all they could ever taste was salt. So what did? They started putting salt on the table. They put salt on all their food so it had some flavor. Okay? So people that are addicted to salt cover all their food with salt because if they don't do that, it tastes like nothing at all. But that should tell you something. Salt destroys your taste buds and you don't taste anything else. Okay? You need to know if you're eating salt. Salt is poisonous to the body. We do not need it. We need organic sodium in every cell of the body. We never need sodium chloride, which is a poison. We never ever need sodium chloride. Okay? But this is how salt came into being used. How did pepper come into use? Anybody? Well, sometimes the meat rotted anyway. So they'd cover with pepper so they couldn't taste it. Pepper first showed up on the table to disguise the taste of rotting flesh. And we still have it on the table today, most people do. I don't. Okay? But none of these substances are food. And if you're preparing food, if you're taking beautiful, whole, organic, living fruits and vegetables and adding oil, salt, pepper, etc., you are making that food much less worthwhile, much less healthy, much less valuable than it was before. Because you're including toxic non-foods into the mix. Don't do that. Don't be consuming those things. Not if you want to function at the highest level of health. Most of these substances, now you guys know, because we've been talking about the impact of dehydration on the body. Most people are dehydrated. Well, what does salt do to your body? Dehydrates it. Did you know if you're ever shipwrecked, this is probably a huge concern out in Oklahoma, where you're from, Kat, if you're ever shipwrecked out there in Oklahoma and you don't have any fresh water to drink, don't drink the seawater. You will die faster if you drink the salt water than if you drink nothing at all, because the salt water will dehydrate you. That's what salt does. It pulls the water out of your cells and into solution. Okay? So spices do the same thing. They irritate the body, and the body says, I need a bunch of water to flush this garbage out. They might taste good to you now, but that's because your taste buds, not now, but before, you know, weeks ago when you were still eating, if you remember those days, the old days, back in the old food days, those of you fasting with me. But that's because your taste buds were bastardized by consuming these substances on a consistent basis. They're not food. When you eat these foods, what happens is the real subtle, amazing flavors of mangoes and papayas and watermelons and bananas and peaches and figs and nectarines and, you know, the millions and millions of different fruits out there, they lose their appeal to you. You lose the ability to taste those things when you're used to consuming these strong flavors from salt, pepper, spices, etc. Vinegar, okay? Vinegar is a cellular poison, just like alcohol. In fact, it's wood alcohol. It is alcohol. It's a product of fermentation, and it kills cells on contact. But how about apple cider vinegar? Same thing. Okay? So you're not likely to sit down and have a bowl of vinegar. It's not food. It's not valuable to you. It's not helping you. What many people realize or notice is there's symptomatic relief with certain substances. Garlic is a health food though, right? It's a health food. People eat garlic and they get healthier, don't they? Come on, you guys know this is true.
Antibiotic.
It's a natural antibiotic is what it is, thank you. And what do antibiotics do? They kill living organisms in your body. This very same living organisms that you depend on, not just for your health, but to actually be alive. They kill these things. It's not a health food. People think it's a health food because when they consume garlic, the bacteria die, and the bacteria who were consuming your dead and dying tissue and creating symptoms as a result of that activity, they die, and so there's no more symptoms. So people feel better when they eat garlic. But is it creating a higher level of health? No, it's not. Okay? It's a medicinal substance, and all medicinal substances are toxic to the body because the body's reacting to the poison. So, simple rule. You don't have to remember all that. All you have to remember is this. If I wouldn't sit down and eat it by itself, I shouldn't be eating it at all. It's not food. Does that make sense to everybody? Mm-hmm. I'm not asking if you like it. I'm asking if it makes sense to you. Okay? Any questions on this one?